Think about everything that needed to have happened in the 3 minutes before the plane hit the water. Somehow, Captain Sullenberger and his co-pilot needed to process only the information relevant to the task at hand. They needed to remember plans of emergency procedures. They needed to make rapid decisions and communicate back and forth with the tower. And somehow, through all this, they needed to suppress whatever feelings of terror they must have been feeling at the moment. In other words, all crew and all passengers of Flight 1549 survived because of a complex coordination of attention, memory, decision-making, communication. All of these are topics that lie at the heart of cognitive psychology. What I have here is the very first cognitive psychology textbook ever published. It was published by a psychologist named Ulrich Neisser in 1967. What's really interesting is if you take a look at the table of contents, which supposedly surveys the entire field of cognitive psychology, it's a much more limited array of topics than you would find in your textbook right now. So for example, there's chapters on iconic and verbal coding, pattern recognition, words as visual patterns, visual memory, sentences. That's mostly it. Whereas if you take a look at a textbook from today, you get a bigger array of topics. Things like mental imagery, language, problem solving, memory systems, concepts, reasoning, intelligence, and creativity. A whole host of things that now fall under the field of cognitive psychology. The difference between 1967 and now in the contents of the textbooks really demonstrates just how far the field has come. So where did this field of cognitive psychology come from? It's hard to pinpoint an exact date, but most psychologists would place its dawn around somewhere in the 1950s or the 1960s, a period of time that we now call the cognitive revolution. Now, if it's cognitive revolution, that means it must be rebelling against something. And so the story of what I'm going to tell you today has to do with what this rebellion was against. That movement that was rebelling against was in turn a rebellion against another movement. And then what it was about that particular point of time in the 1950s and the 1960s that led to such a flourishing of research that we now call it the cognitive revolution. The decades leading up to the cognitive revolution were dominated by a field in psychology, a movement in psychology known as behaviorism. Behaviorism was driven by a belief that if you're really going to create a science, an objective science of human behavior, then you really can only focus on things that you can objectively measure. Things like changes in what people actually do in the real world, or changes in outwardly observable behavior as a function of changes in the environment. Now, this sounds like it makes sense. And you have to remember that behaviorism was established because its proponents, known as behaviorists, really, really wanted to turn psychology into an objective science on the level of physics or chemistry. And they had grown fed up of what had come before. See, what had come before, or what had been popular before the behaviorist movement, was something called introspectionism. What this meant, or what this involved, was psychologists looking inwards to their own minds, trying to observe as objectively as they could the processes that form the bases of their thoughts. Well, you can imagine already that this already presents some problems for an objective science. So for example, there are some types of cognitive processes that we might not even be aware of. So how can we introspect about them? So it's a problem of validity. Another problem with introspectionism is that our own memories tend to be fallible. We don't always remember things accurately. So when it comes to recording our own observations of what we experience, we might not even be remembering that right. And a third problem with introspectionism is that it's a very subjective endeavor. Even though different labs were aiming or striving to train their researchers as rigorously as possible, what I see when I look inwards to my mind might be different from what you perceive when you look inwards to your mind. And so that makes it really, really hard for labs around the world to build on each other's work and to create a purely objective science. And so it was in the wake of this kind of the popularity of introspectionism that behaviorism was founded. And its mission was really, really stated quite explicitly by John Watson, now known as the father of behaviorism. He said, "Psychology, as the behaviorist views it, is a purely objective experimental branch of natural science. Its theoretical goal is the prediction and control of behavior. Introspection forms no essential part of its methods, nor is the scientific value of its data dependent upon the readiness with which they lend themselves to interpretation in terms of consciousness." All right. So what we have there is an expression of the ambition of the behaviorists. They really want to turn this into an objective science. But there was that last part where Watson seemed to suggest that the proper study of behavior, or the proper study of psychology, has nothing to do with consciousness or the inner workings of the mind. Instead, the only way to build an objective science of human behavior is to change little things in the environment and see how that changes outwardly observable, outwardly measurable behaviors. And that's where the name behaviorism came from. An example of just how powerfully behaviorist principles could be used to shape and change behavior can be seen in this archival footage I'm about to show you, which shows a very famous psychologist named B.F. Skinner demonstrating how he can shape the behavior of a pigeon so that the pigeon's doing exactly what B.F. Skinner wants it to do. And he does this through the careful administration of rewards and punishments. Basically, the idea is that it's possible to shape animal behavior, and it turns out, people's behavior, by getting them to learn associations between their own actions and the likelihood that they'll experience a pleasant outcome, otherwise known as reward, or an unpleasant outcome, known as a punishment. You'll see that here in this video.